back there. And you know, you'll never grow as a Christian without good music.
Right.
And it's wonderful. And so I believe the $10 a CD, he put the Blue Light Special on. Amen. No, but $10 a CD, and get you some of those CDs. So I didn't bring any money. Well, sorry. No, that'll be fine. Where's Ito at? Brother Ito's got a lot of money, and he will loan it to anybody. Amen. For music.
I got food stamps.
Yeah, he says if you take food stamps, he'll do that. Amen. Yeah. All right, we're selling the CDs for $30 in food stamps. No problem at all. Yeah. Some people in here are trying to figure out how they can buy them now. This, I need food stamps, and I'm going to buy this. And so, Brother Clark, come and get God back in here somehow. That would be a blessing. And then I've got waters here for any of you guys. It's more down there if you want.
Well, it is good to be here. Brother Burton's talking about his introduction. I remember Dr. Lee Robertson was in his late 70s. And so, how many of you have heard that name before? And just a man of God. And my dad never went to Bible college and got saved as a construction worker. And I remember Brother Robertson came to our church. It was a big deal. I remember Dad talking about it being a big deal. But we sang and just did our thing, and offering was over, and Dad gets up, and he had never been to our church before. And Dad just looked and said, Brother Robertson's going to come and preach. And Dad didn't think anything of it. Brother Robertson got up and said, that's the most unusual, shortest introduction I've ever had, Brother Clark. You know, and he just kind of looked at Dad, and my dad's like, I'm like, you didn't really do anything. You just told me, you know, but not that he's looking for that, but I remember that. So, yeah, you'll be all right.
Hey,
I beat
that
referee.
You know what I'm saying?
Yeah. Well, this week was Valentine's. How many of you gave or received a flower? You gave, let me see all those people that are in love out here. Raise your hand. You gave or received a flower. Look at that. How many of you put your hands down? You gave or received a piece of jewelry. Anybody at all? Raise your hands. God, put your hands up. All right. How many of you gave or received something that you can wear? Hat, shirt, anything? Some of you? How many of you got nothing and no one loves you? All right. There's a bunch of us. So often we talk about love, and all you people that watch the Hallmark Channel, every story is the same. They're all the same. Rich person, supposed to marry another rich person, falls in love with poor person, has an attraction, finally decides on the rich person, till they go to the airport, the train station, somewhere. They're at the altar. Someone says, look, you foolish person, the one you really love is that poor one. And they leave the rich person at the altar, and they run down to the train station, airport, whatever, while they're there, and said, I made a mistake, marry me, and then the credits roll. And that's everyone, just time and time again. Like these love stories. Hey, we'll get God back in it. Greatest love story ever.
Amen.
No flowers, no jewelry, no clothes. Just someone giving their life for you and me. And greater love had no man than this, than a man lay down his life for his friends. Hope you love the Lord and all he did for you.
There were no flowers, only thorns, no costly clothes, just a robe that was torn. And he never gave me diamonds or gold, but the story of his love, it's the greatest ever told. He loved me to death until the end, when he prayed, forgive them. It's a love that's not me.
Has done.
worship and adore Him. When I could see no way, He makes a way. And did I mention that He's been faithful to every promise He's ever made me? I love Him. That's all I want to say.
Sing it with us one time. You know the chorus. Sing that out. Here we go.
Did I mention that I love Him? How I worship and adore Him. When I could see no way, He makes a way.
Your parents were saved people. Your parents were saved people. How many of your grandparents were saved people? Hey, they talk about that second and third generation losing it. Not their salvation, but their love for God.
Yeah, right.
I grew up a preacher's kid, so I'm looking at some of you raising your hand. Some of you didn't have that. How many of you were not second generation? You're first generation. And honestly, when they talk about statistically, that's the people that really have a heart for God. Kind of to whom much is forgiven. The more you forgive, the more you love. We ought to drive through, listen to me, all you church brats that grew up in it just like me, and look around and say, by the grace of God. Not only did He save us, He didn't just save us out of it, He saved us from it. The things we don't have scarring our mind. The memories we never made out there in the world. Do you understand? Do you get how good God has been to you? One more time on that chorus.
Did I mention that I love Him? Worship and adore Him. When I could see no way, He makes a way. And did I mention that He's been faithful to every promise He's ever made me? I love Him. That's all I want to say.
Tonight.
Amen.
This world cheers on and gladly identifies with the people they love. There are people all over the city wearing 76ers jerseys, and our team is awful. A lot of Steph Curry jerseys. A few weeks back, a lot of New England Patriots jerseys. When the campaigns were going strong, a lot of I'm with Bernie, I'm with Hillary, I'm with Trump. Can I tell you, people, I hope they do well, but people are people.
Yeah, that's right.
And people fail you.
Yeah, that's right.
I hope our president does some good things, but my confidence, I can't say I'm standing 100% with anybody.
Amen.
Other than God. Can I tell you, God went to the cross for you.
Yeah.
And He went to the cross for me.
Thank God.
Do you gladly identify with Him?
Amen.
Toward the end there, and I love Peter, but they said, you're with Him. You look like Him. You speak like Him. And he said, blankety blank blank, I don't even know Him.
Yeah.
Teenagers, singles.
God help us.
Liberty Baptist Church, you gladly stand with God. He stood with you. He went to the cross. He took the thorns, took the beating to save your soul. Not only should we not turn our back on Him, but we ought to gladly stand and say, I'm a child of God. By the grace of God. Mock me if you might.
Right.
Whatever, I'm standing with God.
Man.
One day we're going to see Him.
Yeah.
Hope you love the Lord. Hope you're proud in the right sense to be a child of God.
Amen.
The angry crowd cried out to crucify. They nailed him to a rugged cross and left him there to die. They gambled for the royal robe he wore, not knowing they had crucified my Lord. He bore the sin and shame of all mankind, and as he hung there dying, I was on his mind. The sacrifice and love some don't appreciate, but I would like to speak and set the record straight. That's my God. Some say he's nothing more than a fairy tale. He's just a myth or legend, and his presence is not real. His word is not correct politically. They curse and mock his name defiantly. Oh, but time has never changed the changeless one, and their lies cannot disprove the existence of God's Son. Though some may be content to just sit by, I for one must stand and testify. That's my God, and I love
two more songs as the Lord leads here. And you know, the reason you don't have to have introductions is because I'm home, see. And we give each other a hard time, but I just feel so at home here. You know, and only the Lord can do that, because I'm not from a place, I'm not from the city. I don't know if y'all can tell. And where I live now is not the big city, is that right? Y'all been there? But it's a big city compared to where I'm from. Where I'm from is the absolute middle of nowhere, Kentucky. You can't even get there from here. You got to go somewhere else and start to get there. The Lord found us, changed our whole family. And I was thinking while they were singing this earlier, and you know, you said, well, we've sung a lot. You know, he's worthy of so much worship.
Yeah, amen.
And I preached kind of worship the first two nights. I'm not going to do that tonight. I've got a very practical truth tonight, kind of a almost pastoral message, but I just feel like the Lord had me give it to you tonight. But before I get into that, I just wanted to sing this again. I want us to think about it. Some of you know the chorus. You can help them sing on the chorus. And you need to make yourself look what God has done for you. You got to look at it sometimes, because your eyes can be consumed by the problems. The storm captivates your vision. But you got to close your eyes sometimes and just start looking through your life. And you see divine appointments. One of the things, Brother Mike, and you guys have been traveling your whole life. One of the things that I've discovered about traveling these last few years is the great blessing, sister, of the friendships God has given me in all these different places. And I praise him. I'm so attention deficit and schizophrenic, all of that, that I can't pray like everybody else. And a few years ago, I heard a guy that talked about writing. And so I have to write while I'm praying just to stay focused. And so I have a little way I do it. Roman numeral 1, I praise. I start writing some things down to praise for. And Roman numeral 2, repent. And then Roman numeral 3, special needs. And then I get into some prayer list. But there have been a thing that recently as I've traveled some that I've been praising the Lord for is his favor in my relationships. And I'm not just talking about my family, which certainly that's at the top of the list, but friends that he has given me that really, if you had found me in Kentucky all them years ago and told me that I would have friends in all these places and that some of these people would be my friends, I'd say, well, that's crazy. That'll never happen. Them people ain't never going to know us. And just look back and you start seeing what we call now divine appointments. Where God did it. Me and Brother Burton, we was trying to figure it out how I had him at our church mission conference. I couldn't even remember how it happened. He says he just called me out of the blue. And while he was saying that, I was thinking, why in the world did I say yes? I didn't know him. You know, most of the time, these guys will tell you, you kind of know somebody that knows somebody that knows somebody before you just say, yeah, they can come and jump up in your pulpit. The first time he jumped up in our pulpit, he just said, starting a church in Philly, and I don't need your prayers, I need your money, and I've got to leave. It's good to meet y'all. And he left because there was some guy supposed to meet him. And we were like, we love that guy. We just fell in love with him. And that, you know, we thought we was just taking on a missionary, but God has used this family to be such a blessing to our family and this church to be such a blessing to our church. And then some years ago, the Lord connected us with the Clark family. And I consider them some of our dearest friends.
Amen.
And we're as different, I mean, really, initially, who would have ever thought that we'd all be friends? But we love them, and I think they love us. And my life has been impacted as a Christian because God has brought me into these other lives and brought them into my life. I'm a better person because of meeting Brother Burton and his family and the Clark family and some of you. And that's the blessings of God. See, we just take that stuff for granted. We just think, oh, you know, we're just living life. No, well, there's a great big God in heaven, and he cares about me so much. And he guides and directs, and sometimes, thank God, I listen to him, and I'm in the right place at the right time, and he brings something in my life that will change it forever. And he brings, I thought about Liberty here, this church, and I know we got a lot of visitors, but the church here, what a blessing this church is. What a blessing that God brought this family right here. Amen. That's divine. I'll tell you one story. And I grew up, I was in church my whole life, but I'd never been in the kind of preaching and the kind of churches that you guys have been in. We had a different preacher, I told you the other night, all the time. And so I'd never really heard preaching about giving your whole life to God and things like that. And I remember when I was in high school, none of my family had ever gone to college. None of the Shirleys, my dad had 12 brothers and sisters. I don't think any of them or their children had ever. My two brothers had graduated high school. They were the first of the grandkids to ever graduate high school. And then I wanted to go to college. I didn't want to work on the farms, and that's all there was. And I thought, I'm going to college so I don't have to work on the farm. And I didn't have the money. And we started filling out applications. And I was going to be a school teacher. And I filled out this thing. A bunch of my friends at school that were going to be teachers, they filled it out. It's called the Kentucky Teacher Higher Education Scholarship. And several of them got it. And what it said was that for every year you teach, then you don't have to pay back that year of college. So basically, as long as you teach 4 years, your college was free. Now, they had a couple stipulations. One is you couldn't change your mind. If you changed your mind and changed your major, then you had to pay that money back plus 17% interest. It was a big penalty. And the other one was they were trying to increase the education in Kentucky. I mean, we're pretty intelligent anyway, but they was trying to make it a little better. And so they said, if you take this, you have to teach in the state of Kentucky. And if you go out of state and teach, then you have to pay it back plus interest. I had no visions of ever leaving, and so I filled that thing out, and a bunch of my friends, two or three of them, got it, and we thought maybe I was going to get it, and I got a letter in the mail, and I'm just telling you this to say that I wasn't praying about the will of God, because I'd never been told that. Now, you know, I loved God, I played the piano, sang, and went to church all the time, taught Sunday school, different things, but I'd never been taught what some of you have been taught, so I wasn't saying, oh God, I need you to give me the right thing, I was just living. And I got a letter that said, this thing's out of money. There's no more of that teacher scholarship. And my mom was pretty tore up. And I was like, well, you know, whatever. I didn't really understand it all. But we had filled out several things. And a couple days later, I got a letter in the mail. Now, my mom was praying. Let me say that. I wasn't praying, but Mama was praying. And I got a letter in the mail, and it was about, it was called the Paul Douglas Teacher Scholarship, and it was almost identical to that one, except you had to teach 2 years for every year. Well, I didn't intend to not teach, so I didn't care if it was 8 years or four. So the idea was they would pay for my college, and once I taught 8 years, it'd be completely paid off. So I took it. It was a blessing in my freshman year, sophomore year, junior year. Between my junior and senior years when I heard that preaching. And I gave my whole life to God. And then I met the pastor of the church that I'm at now. And we became kind of friends. And we had a little youth choir that would sing for them. And he would come preach for us. And man, they had had a major move of God at camp in 1994. And my wife now, she had gotten right. A whole bunch of others had gotten right. And he started talking to me one day. He said, I'm just asking youth workers around the country what they think. He said, I think we need to start a school. And he didn't know what I was going to school for. He said, I think we need to start a school. What would you say about that? And again, I'd never heard of Christian schools like that. But I said, well, I would say that I'll graduate in May and I can teach math, history, computer science. And he said, man, something might have just clicked like that. And I thought, man, it might have. And I just wanted at that point whatever God wanted. I didn't know what it was. Some time passed. I got back into my first semester of my senior year. And the letter came. You had to fill it out every semester. You had to write your name and sign it and agree to all these things. And then they would send you that semester's money. Now, I was a typical 18, 19, 20-year-old. I'd never read that thing. I'm like, I'll sign it. You send me money. That's the way this works. But now I'm thinking, how can I go to North Carolina and work for half the money and pay back all of that plus 17% interest? I was thinking, I just don't know if I can do it. Maybe I'm going to have to teach in Kentucky 8 years and then go or something. I just kind of flipping out about it. I got that letter. I started reading it real close this time. And turns out that Kentucky Higher Education one, when it ran out, it was you had to teach in the state. But this one was called Paul Douglas because some rich guy died and left a bunch of money. Turns out it was a federal one, which meant this. Here's what it said exactly. The other thing I started thinking, Brother Burton, was the Kentucky one, you had to teach in a public school. Had to be in a Kentucky public school. And I thought, well, I ain't teaching in no public school, doesn't look like, so I'm going to be stuck with all this debt. And then I read it, and it said this. You can teach in any school, any state, public or private school. And I started thinking about God.
Yeah.
4 years before that, before I ever asked Him, before I ever said, Lord, I want your will. I want to go to North Carolina. I believe it's what you want. Before I'd ever even done any of that, He was guiding things and working it out for me. And see, when I moved to North Carolina, I wasn't even called to preach. I went there to teach and coach basketball. And man, I was 22 years old and I was an absolute maniac. I'm going to tell you the truth. Y'all think I'm wild now. You should have seen me then. And I didn't have any intentions of ever being a preacher. But see, God knew all of it. God knew the trouble was going to come. He knew He was going to call me to preach that second year. He knew that He was eventually going to call me to pastor. He knew all of that. But see, I didn't have any idea. And I wasn't even talking to Him when He started working it all out. And I look back and I think, boy, look what God did. How when I wasn't even asking Him, He was guiding my life. And He was looking ahead and He was saying, I got some really good things for you. I would never have even known y'all. I would never have even known y'all. Hey, Liberty, I would never have known you. Except God, way before I was even asking, was so good to me. He loved me so much that He was already working things out. And I live the blessed life that I have now because God has been good. You need to look in your life tonight while they're singing this, and you need to find some divine little things that if just one or two of them had gone another way, you would not have the life that you have right now. And if just one or two of them, hey listen, if just maybe Grandma and Grandpa hadn't got saved, y'all might have all been Catholic kids. And I got news for you. You wouldn't know nothing about the joy of the Lord.
Right.
You wouldn't know nothing about the goodness of God.
Right.
Hey, you wouldn't know half what you know. But God got involved and He started working little things out. And just think about it while they're singing this. Let's pray. Let's ask God to make it real to us what He has done. Look what God, if you have to close your eyes to get past your current problem, you do that and you look in your heart. God has been good to us. Magnificently good.
Amen.
To this crowd in here tonight. You understand, you could have been born in any country in the world. And I'd say most of us were born in this one, where it was perfectly free for a man to come, buy a building, put up a sign, start telling your family about Jesus.
Yeah.
It changed everything. Go ahead.
I just felt like the Lord wanted me to give a testimony
today. Sure.
He just, we drove up here tonight. I was just doing my own thing, thinking about what we're going to sing, and, you know, and as we drove through these streets, Maria. And I wasn't ready for it, to be honest. And I just want to praise the Lord because I know where I should be tonight. And I didn't grow up in a Christian home. My daddy's still not saved. My mom's passed on. She's in heaven. She struggled with addictions, and she went home earlier than she should have. But somebody knocked on my door when I was a little girl.
How about that?
And asked me if I wanted to ride the bus. And I wasn't looking for God. I thought I was good enough. As a little kid, I thought, if my good outweighs my bad, I'll go to heaven. No one ever told me that. I'd never been to church. And God was looking for me. And I could have never dreamed what God would do with my life. And I remember going to church and thinking, wow, that's the kind of life I want. I'm looking at Pastor Clark and his family and saying, man, if I could have that kind of life, that would be awesome. And here I am. And every day I wake up and I'm just, praise the Lord. And I,
bless his holy name.
I love the Lord. And every day I just want to live my life to love him back for how good he's been to me. And I don't always do a good job, but I just want to praise him tonight. And maybe you walked in here tonight and you don't have hope, you're lost, you have a lot of problems. Can I just tell you, the Lord is awesome.
Yeah.
And if you just surrender your life to him, he's going to do amazing things.
Yes, he is.
He is great at taking bad things and making great things out of it.
Yes,
and sometimes they're our own doing, and sometimes they're not, and he fixes it all.
Yeah, that's right.
So I just love the Lord, and I just felt like God wanted me to say that.
Amen. Thank the Lord for that. One of the boys, I think it's probably Trav, the other night, and I know it's very basic, but he looked at me, probably Valentine's, and said, Dad, if you didn't marry Mom, I wouldn't be me. Not that he's anything, you understand. But God has a big plan.
Yes, he does.
And maybe one of you put it out there, I just read it in the last few days. It says, if God says no, he's got a better plan.
Yeah.
When I was Mike's age, the Valentine stuff I had wasn't for Carla, it was for someone else. That whole thing kind of went to pieces.
Yeah.
And it was upsetting. But God has a better plan.
Yeah.
You may be going through something, Brother Tony alluded to it. Maybe there's a difficulty, something you're kind of scratching your head. Hey, hang in there. God knows what he's doing.
Yes, he does.
There's all kind of ways to worship the Lord. You can stand and do it. You can raise your hand. You can sit. You can pray and do it. Ever have you feel like you need to worship him for what he's done in your life? You do it during this song. Y'all sing. Even if I talk, y'all keep singing.
When you were hungry,
yeah.
Sent manna from above.
Think about it.
When you needed shelter,
let's just go ahead and stand.
He covered you with his love.
Through trials and through blessings, he's been faithful and true.
Look what God has done for you.
Good morning, if you don't know, it's pretty easy.
Look what. He's done what no other can do.
Look what God.
Look what God has done for you.
no other can do. Look what God has done for you. He's done what no other can do. Look what God, look what God, look what God has done for you.
We all right on time, aren't we, Brother Burton? Just the book song. One of the best things God did for us was this book. And I'm going to preach a little message, and I'll go quickly, I will. I know it's already, we've been here a while. But I want you to listen while they sing this one, and that'll be kind of the introduction to the message. And we take it for granted, many of us, because we've had it in our lives. We had a missionary come through from what we would call Burma, Myanmar, something like that. And they didn't have the Bible in their language, and the missionary found out and started working on it, finally got it in their language. They were shipping them a whole bunch. And if the local governments would have found out, they would have stopped them. And so when they finally got some there off the ships and got them loaded into the trucks, this pastor, he was in our church, this pastor said, he told him, he said, I'm going to ride down here with the Bibles under this truck. He said, because whatever's going to happen to them is going to happen to me. He rode under the truck in the container part, and he said, and it was hot. But he said, what if they were going to stop us and take them, that he was going to be taken with it. One load they brought, not the truck he was in, it got stopped on this mountainous road by the police, and they stopped all their trucks and started talking to them and said, we want to see what's in the back. And they were trying to get away. They said, well, open the door. And right before they were going to cut a box open, and if they found the Bibles, they would have taken them all and probably arrested them guys. Right before they did, they got radioed. There was some kind of trouble over there, and they needed those soldiers over at that trouble. So right before they cut the boxes open, they had to leave. They shut the truck door and kept going. That same truck got into the city, and one story said that in the city they got stopped again, like the police had stopped them there. And this cop started talking to them again, started questioning them again, and went all the way to the back again, and this time opened the door, this time opened the box, and jerked out a Bible. What is this? And they started telling him. He says to him, he says, if you'll give me one, I'll let you go. They said, you can have one. Those Bibles got to that village. Sometime later, the Muslims came in, raided that village, burned it to the ground. The natives there living, they escaped, many of them as they could, and they started sending word to the American missionary that works with them. He comes back and forth. They started sending word, said, we're in trouble, we're in trouble. When he finally got everything arranged for a place for them to go, when they got there over and over, most of them kept saying, we couldn't save anything, but we saved our Bible.
Amen.
But we saved our Bible.
Amen.
Because they never had it. And it meant something to them. Listen, yeah, while they sing this, think about your Bible.
I'm amazed every day when I sit down and open up the Bible. Sometimes I sigh, sometimes I cry, sometimes I feel my spirit have revival. It satisfies my soul. It's hope that I can hold. Lord, I thank you for the book you've given. Word of life, breath of heaven. Perfect truth from page to page that you've preserved from age to age. From Genesis to Revelation, anywhere I look. Every phrase leads me straight to Jesus. Lord, I thank you for the book. The master plan revealed to man, written with the hands of inspiration. When questions rise, situation. As I begin to read, it meets me at my need. Lord, I thank you for the book you've given, word of life, breath of heaven, perfect truth from page to page that you've preserved from age to age, from Genesis to Revelation, anywhere I look. Every phrase leads me straight to Jesus. Lord, I thank you for the book. Lord, I thank you for the book you've given, word of life, breath of heaven, perfect truth from page to page that you've preserved from age to age, from Genesis to Revelation, anywhere I look. Every phrase leads me straight to Jesus. Lord, I thank you for the book.
Y'all want some water? This bunch under here, it looks like. All right, Amos chapter 8, if you want to look there. Amos chapter 8. Boy, it's good to be in church tonight, isn't it?
Amen.
Praise God for the opportunity to be in church. And Liberty, I do love you. I appreciate how good you always are to me. And what's it? All right, if you're visiting and you don't have a Bible, bring one. There's some in the backs of the pews there. If you want to try and follow along, don't be ashamed at all to go to the index and try to find your page if you need to do that. Let's all stand. That's a custom around here to stand. Amos chapter 8. Stretch your legs a little bit. And I will say in Liberty, I appreciate how good you are to me, and my family wants to come. We're trying to work it out. The next time we have kind of this meeting, maybe change it in the calendar. This is just a bad time for my family to travel, so we're going to talk, me and Brother Burton, about that. So I'd love for them to be able to come, because they love you guys too. And so we praise the Lord for the opportunity to be here. Amos chapter 8, verse 11. You pray for me. We went out today and played some balls, Brother Burton said. You get out there, and this is when you know you're getting old. I already knew I was getting old. But we had already won a couple games, and then these young boys came on the court, and they was ready to try to knock us off. And they was debating among themselves who's going to guard who. And this one guy's like, who am I guarding? And they all pointed at me and said, you're guarding old head right there. It wasn't a bit right. I thought, well, we're not in Kansas anymore, Toto, I'll tell you that. In Nebo, they don't call me that, praise God. And so I got out there. You know what that does? That just fires you up. You play a little harder. You forget that you are old, and then when I went in, my back was saying, are you stupid? That's what my back has been saying to me ever since. I said that word again. I ain't supposed to say stupid. Sorry about that. But that's what my back has been saying to me. So I may just fall out right in the middle of preaching. If I do, Brother Burton, just jump here and finish, and that'll be great. Amos chapter 8, verse 11. Behold, the days come, saith the Lord God, that I will send a famine, look at this, in the land. Not a famine of bread, nor a thirst for water, but of hearing the words of the Lord. And notice that. He said, I will send a famine up in the land, not a famine of bread, nor a thirst for water, but of hearing the words of the Lord. That's what we're reading right now, by the way, the word of the Lord. And they shall wander from sea to sea, and from the north even to the east. And they shall run to and fro to seek the word of the Lord. And look, shall not find it. In that day shall the fair virgins and the young men faint for thirst. Father, I pray you'd help me now. Just say exactly what you'd have me say. Thank you for the sweet spirit that's been in this place. And we do thank you, Lord, for all the things you've done for us. And not just what you've done, but who you are. I'm thankful that you're good, that you're merciful, you're long-suffering, that you're holy. And I'm thankful, Lord, you'd have anything to do with us. I pray that you'd bless tonight the rest of this service, bless this message. Lord, for anybody here that's not for sure, if they died today, that they'd go to heaven. I pray that you'd speak to them, that they'd want to know, and they could be saved today. Even though I'm not really preaching that kind of message, Lord, your word has the power to speak to a heart, and I pray you'd do that. We'll praise you for it in Jesus' name. And all God's people said,
amen.
You can be seated. I want to address something that I believe is extremely important if there's ever to be a sustained move of God in any particular place. In Liberty Baptist Church, if God is going to continue to do great works here, and also in the new property that you guys are praying about and raising money for, and already, I believe, about to sign the papers on, if there's going to be an extended and sustained move of God, there's some things that we have to give attention to. There's some things that we'll have to sustain if we're going to sustain a move of God. Now, in these verses, one of the punishments of God on a people who refuse to accept and hear the truth spoken by God's prophets is that God said, I will send a famine. So what do you mean? I mean, the nation had not listened to the prophets that God had sent them. He had sent them a lot of truth. He had sent men speaking truth. And He had given them opportunities to accept the truth, and they had rejected it repeatedly. And so God says to them, He says, so now what I'm going to do is I'm going to send you a famine. And you'll notice in verse 12 it said, they will seek the word of the Lord and shall not find it. So He's saying, you had it, you refused to receive it, and so the punishment is going to be that there will be a day when you won't be able to find it if you want it. Now, some of you know that this was fulfilled in the nation of Israel, their history, when the Jewish people were sent into the Babylonian captivity. They were taken into captivity by Babylon, and they did not have the prevalency of the Word of God or prophets as much as they had. And then it especially happened in the 400 years from Malachi to Matthew, where there was no prophet at all. Nobody was speaking the Word of the Lord for those 400 years. Now we realize that as we go further into these last days, and we are living in the last days, that more and more people are going to turn away from the truth. That's just the way the Bible says it's going to be. Broad is the way that leadeth unto destruction, and many there be. Narrow is the way that leadeth unto life, and few there be. We know that the prophecies say there's going to be a great falling away. We know that Paul said that this know also in the last days perilous times shall come, for men shall be lovers of their own selves, covetous, boasters, proud, blasphemers, disobedient to parents, unthankful, unholy. We could talk about all of those, how we see them in our nation and in the world. And then he said, having a form of godliness, but denying the power thereof, from such turn away. Ever learning. Listen to what he said about the last days. Ever learning and never able to come to the knowledge of the truth. Then he said, now as Jannes and Jambres withstood Moses, that was the Egyptian sorcerers, if you will, it says, so do these also resist the truth. Men of corrupt minds, reprobate concerning the faith. Paul goes on to admonish Timothy, and he says, this is how you're going to have to deal with that. He said, you're going to be in a day, and the last days are going to be such that they are going to resist truth, and they're going to turn from truth. And so he says, you're going to have to continue thou in the things which thou hast learned and been assured of, knowing of whom thou hast learned them, and that from a child thou hast known, listen, the Holy Scriptures, which are able to make thee wise unto salvation through faith which is in Christ Jesus. Here's what he's saying to Timothy. He's saying in the last days, and even in your days, Timothy, they're going to not want the truth. They're going to turn from the truth. And what we see in the book of Amos is that part of God's punishment when people resist truth is that truth will dwindle so that even if they decide they want it at a later date, they might not be able to find it. And so Paul is saying, Timothy, if there's going to be hope for those few who start looking for truth, it's going to be in you. And here's what he said. It's going to be in you continuing in what you've already learned. And he particularly says that from a child you have known the Holy Scriptures. He said, Timothy, if there's going to be hope for people to find the Word of God in those last days, he said, it's going to be people like you that have been given it who will preserve it. And so as the famine progresses in our land, where will they find bread? The spiritual bread from heaven, which is the Word of God. A famine, it said in Amos, he said, not of bread, not a famine of bread, nor thirst for water, but of hearing the words of the Lord. But we know the Bible is a picture. Bread is often a picture of the Bible in the Word of God. And so my question to you is that in these last days, where are people who come to themselves and realize, man, I need something that my life don't have. I need something from God. I need to go somewhere and find out something about God. Where are they going to find bread in these last days? Are they going to be able to find a place where the Word of God still is? Now let me show you very quickly. We're not going to turn to this first one. Go ahead and turn to Genesis 41. But in Jeremiah 38, the Bible says this about a city. It was the city of Jerusalem right before they were being taken into captivity. It said that there is no more bread in the city. Jerusalem had been surrounded by the Chaldeans, and they were about to be taken captive, and so they had surrounded them and cut off all their supplies, and that attack had lasted so long that there is now no more bread in the city. Now listen to me. That means that there is no plan that had been presented, no preparations had been made, and so the city finds itself with no bread. And that's a picture of this famine we read about in Amos, a picture of a place where you cannot find the truth of the Word of God, where you can't find somebody still preaching the old-time way, still teaching the old time way. You say, but isn't it going to last forever? Yeah, the word of God will stand forever. But I'm going to tell you, part of the punishment for our country and the world will be that it's going to get harder and harder to find the real truth of the word of God in these last days. In Genesis 41, we look at a different city. Genesis 41, verse 54, we're looking at the land of Egypt and their capital city. And the Bible said in Genesis 41, 54, and the 7 years of dearth or famine began to come as according as Joseph had said, and the dearth or the famine was in, look at this, all lands, but in all the land of Egypt, say them last three words, there was bread. Now, in Jeremiah said they'd got to the place in that city, there was no bread in the city. But here we see there's been a lengthy famine in this town. There's been a lengthy dearth, a lengthy time where there wasn't any rain and most everybody's running out of food. And it says that this famine was in all the lands. It said, but in Egypt there was bread. After 7 years of famine. Many of you know that Pharaoh had a dream that he didn't understand. And basically when God brought Joseph into his life, Joseph was able to say to him that what it meant was you're going to have 7 years of great plenty and then 7 years of famine. He said, but the 7 years of famine are going to be so devastating, it'll completely wipe out those 7 years of plenty. And certainly as he prophesied, that came to pass. And what we're reading here is the end of those 7 years, everybody's out of food except word starts spreading that over there in Egypt there's still some bread. Chapter 42 verse 5 said, for the famine was in the land of Canaan. It had extended well beyond Egypt and it had gotten in the other lands. Hey, but in Egypt there was still bread. I could ask this question. In the midst of a terrible famine, how was there a place where there was still bread? When everywhere else there was none, how did it work out that there was still bread here in Egypt? Well, let me just say this. The world that we're in right now is in a famine of the Word of God. Sadly, even many of the churches today have minimized the importance of the Bible. If we, you know, David Gibbs, he gave a statistic years ago that said only 4% of professing born-again Christians have ever read the entire Bible.
Wow.
Only 4%. Now you think about that. We're the people that say this is God's Word. We're the people that say that this book has the answers to all life's problems. We're the people that say that if you need to know something, you can open this and it'll help show you what you need to know. And yet only 4% have ever read the entire book all the way through. You know what that is? That's a famine for the Word of God. Now listen, beyond our good churches and us still not reading it and looking into it like we should, the other so-called churches, to be honest with you now, some of the new modern things, they are minimizing the importance of the Bible. They've magnified their programs and their worship bands and their fellowships and all that stuff. And there's nothing wrong with fellowship. There's nothing wrong with some of this other stuff. But I'm going to tell you, you better not minimize the Word of God. And they have minimized the preaching and the teaching of the Word of God. And sadly, when many of them do open the book, they are not opening the real version that is the Word of God. They're opening a false version that has no power.
Yep.
And have the words all messed up and the meanings all changed because of that. And the ones that do open it, they will not often preach the whole counsel of God. They only pick certain parts and preach that because they believe that's what people would like to hear. And that's what people would feel warm and fuzzy about and keep coming. And it's just all about never offending anybody. But you know, there are parts of this book that will offend us if we read it.
Right. Yeah.
What I'm telling you is that we're living in a day where there is a famine of the Word of God. And what I'm going to say to you tonight, and I won't be much longer, is this. As this famine for the Word of God spreads throughout our world, I want there to be a little town in western North Carolina where people say this. At New Manna Baptist Church, there's bread. If your life's falling apart and you need something from God, I want the people in our part of the world to say, if you don't know anything else, you can go over to New Manna and they'll tell you about God. They'll tell you about the Bible. Hey, I want them to say this, that in the Badlands of Philadelphia, there's a church over there called Liberty, and you can find bread right there. Hey, they opened the book, and they preached the book, and they teach the book, and they study the book. Hey, listen, there needs to be churches. Hey, there's going to have to be some people who, like Timothy said to, like Paul said to Timothy, from a child you have known the Scriptures. There's going to be some of them that will grab this book and hold on to it and say, hey, when our children grow up, there needs to be some places that still have the Word of God and still lift it high and still say it has the answers. Hey, but that's not going to happen unless consciously some of us say, we are going to preserve what has been given to us.
Amen.
I want there to be a church right here, a couple of blocks away, when they get that other one going, where the people in this neighborhood, when their life might be crumbling and they don't know where else to look, they can bump into somebody, and they may not know everything, but they know this, that Brother Burton Gates down there, they'll show you what the Bible says.
Amen.
The book, Brother Burton, I appreciate your emphasis on the Bible. And I know that this year he's given an emphasis on the Bible. And I want to say to this church, hey, don't you minimize that. That is the leadership of God through the preacher. Because we're in a day when there is a famine. I want there to be a church over in Berlin, New Jersey, no matter. And you know what? The rest of the country, a lot of the rest of the country looks to you guys. They come to the summit. We come to these other meetings. And you know what? They need to always know, hey, that they can go there and find the bread of heaven. We need to always know, hey, when you need a shot in the arm, when you need some help, when you need encouragement, you get over to Berlin at Solid Rock and they'll open that old King James Bible and they'll give you bread from heaven so you can go on. I was at the summit this year. You know what it was? It was bread from heaven. Everybody that came needing something, if they wanted it, they got it. And they went back home. That's not because you're anything, but it's because the book is everything.
Amen.
And there is still a church over there where you can find bread. Even though there's a famine everywhere else, they said, but in Egypt there's bread. And listen, before you make light of this thought, and again, just a few more minutes tonight, let me point out a few things you lose if we don't guard the Bible. You know, we lose our power if we don't have the Bible.
Yeah.
Romans 1:16, for I am not ashamed of the gospel of Christ, for it, the gospel, is the power of God unto salvation. We have no power without this book. We lose our faith, Romans 10:12. So then faith cometh by hearing, and hearing by the what?
Word of God.
Hey, we lose our purity if we don't have this book and we're not preaching this book. The book cleans us. Psalm 119, verse 9. Wherewithal shall a young man cleanse his way? By taking heed thereto, according to thy word. Sanctify them, John 17:17. Through thy word is truth. Ephesians 5:26. That he might sanctify and cleanse it, the church, with the washing of the water by the word. Hey, listen, we lose our power if we don't preserve, if we don't fight, if we don't hold to this book and lift it up and teach it. We lose our faith. We lose our purity. We lose our hope without the Bible. Romans 15:4. For we through patience and comfort of the scriptures might have hope. Do you know why we can shout last night and the night before about in any problem we've got Jesus? Because this book tells us that. Because this book tells the story of the three Hebrew children who stood for the faith and were thrown in the fiery furnace. And in the midst of the fire, they looked and there was the Lord.
Right.
You know how I know that? Because he wrote it in the book and somebody showed me. Hey, we know that the disciples were tossed in that storm and they thought they were going under. And then Jesus come walking on their storm. You know where I learned that? In the Bible.
Amen.
So when I'm in a storm, Brother David, when I'm about to go down, all of a sudden I need hope, I need faith. I begin to remember the Bible, and the Bible gives me my hope to go on, and the Bible gives me my faith to keep walking. Hey, if we lose the Word of God, we lose all these things.
Yeah.
We need to make sure there's bread in this place right here.
Yes, sir.
If the Lord lets me keep coming back, we better keep coming back and saying, let's preach the Bible.
Yeah.
Amen, this King James Bible. How did Egypt have bread when everybody else lost? Very quickly, they took God's warning serious. That's the first thing. God sent the warning through Pharaoh's dream and Joseph's interpretation. And God sent it so that they would heed it and he could save the Jews years later. But you know what? Nothing would have happened if when he prophesied that dream and its meaning, they would have just brushed it off, but they didn't. Pharaoh took God's warning seriously. The first thing that we need to understand is that there's some warnings in the Bible that God says, if you don't give attention to it, there'll be a famine of the Word of God. People will want it and not be able to find it anymore. We need to take that personally and seriously. See, as my children grow up, and one of these days I die and go off the scene, and according to them ballplayers, it won't be too long. Amen. I want them to be able to find churches where the Bible is preeminent and where the Holy Spirit is there. I want them to be able to go to meetings where they can still cry and shout and go to the altar during the singing. And listen, that doesn't just happen by accident. It's got to be consciously protected.
Yeah.
And Egypt heeded the warning. They took the warning of God seriously. And we need to take the warnings. Matthew 24:11 said, and many false prophets shall arise and shall deceive many. That's a warning for us. We can't just be haphazard and think everything's going to be all right. We have to give attention to this book that we have been given from a child. First of all, they took God's warning seriously. Secondly, God sent them a man. In chapter 41, if you look over at that, in verse 33, It says, now therefore let Pharaoh look out a man discreet and wise and set him over the land of Egypt. Part of the prophecy was, Pharaoh, this is going to happen just like God said. And if y'all got any hope of surviving this famine, he said, you better find you a man that is wise and discreet. And many of you know that Pharaoh chose Joseph. And Joseph was sent by God to this place, to this particular time in history. And God sent him there so that there would be bread when the Jews ran out over in Canaan. So that when they ran out over there and the Jewish nation wouldn't, listen, the Jewish nation can't die out because the Messiah has to come through them.
Yes, sir.
So God's always got a plan on how He's going to save them and make sure they make it through. So you know what He did? He sent a man to Egypt. And that man's very purpose was so that when all the bread was out over there, somebody would say, hey, Dad, I heard they've got bread in Egypt. And I'm going to tell you something. I know that I'm nothing. I know that. I know that I don't deserve anything that I have. But I believe this. I believe that God has placed me in our church for this time. I believe I'm supposed to be the pastor of the New Manna Baptist Church. And I feel a personal responsibility to work at making sure that the bread of life can always be found there. So that when people in that town, and we're just a little small country town, but we have a real bad issue with meth and some other drugs like that. Heroin's come back in our town real bad. And you know, we're getting ready to start an RU program. We never had one before. Amen. And you know what I want when word begins to spread and people's lives start falling apart? I want word to spread that, hey, there's a church over there that'll love you. There's a church over there that'll help you. There's a church over there that'll give you the Bible. They'll tell you what it says and that God can help you. And I believe God's put me there to help make sure that that can stay. And I'm going to tell you something. God sent you a man liberty. God brought him here.
Yeah.
God placed this family right here. And Brother Burton, it's your responsibility to make sure that when all things are falling apart in these people's lives around here, that they know there's a place over here on the corner of these streets where the bread of life can be found.
Yeah.
And God sent them a man. And listen, not only that, the man had a plan and the people worked. And I'm preaching to liberty right now. Verse 33 to 36, chapter 41. He said, now therefore let Pharaoh look out a man discreet and wise and set him over the land. Let Pharaoh do this and let him appoint officers over the land and take up the fifth part of the land of Egypt in the seven plenteous years. And let them gather all the food of those good years that come and lay up corn under the hand of Pharaoh and let them keep food in the cities. And that food shall be restored to the land against the 7 years of famine, which shall be in the land of Egypt, that the land perish not through the famine. And so they took God's warning seriously. God sent them a man. That man had a plan, and the people worked the plan. Verse 37 says, and the thing was good in the eyes of Pharaoh and in the eyes of all his servants. Now, I'm going to say something to you. Some of you that even go, you know, whatever church you go to, the preachers of your church, they're not perfect. And we don't have all the answers. And we don't always get it right, Brother Burke. But we want to. We mean right. And we want to preserve the Word of God for our town, for our city, for our place. But I understand we're not perfect, but nonetheless, we're the one God gave you. And God has given him some plans. We didn't just, listen, we don't just make stuff up. We get afraid to tell you. We fret, don't we, Brother Burton, on, man, is this God, or did I dream this up? And you know, I guarantee you, Miss Kara can tell you that Burton lays in the bed sometimes and says, I don't know about this. Maybe I'm just wound up. Maybe it's just, listen, and we want to make sure it's God. When we get up here and tell you, we've tried our best to find out for sure if it's God. So when we give you a plan, you need to be willing to. See, Brother Burton has issued some Bible plan this year, hadn't you, Brother Burton? He didn't know I was going to preach this, but throughout this weekend I've heard that he is pushing the church a little bit about the Bible. And he's challenged you personally to read it. Brother Charlie got up last night and said the first time he read the Bible cover to cover, he was 11 years old. And I didn't read it through when I was 11 years old. But you know what? When I moved to New Manna, I was 22. And my wife had got right with God. She was my fiancée right when I moved there. We got married a month later. And we'd known each other for 10, not 1 month, even though that would have been all right. But some of you thought, yeah, there's Kentucky, praise God. Meet your cousin, she's pretty, you marry her next month. That ain't how it works, all right? And she wasn't from Kentucky, so I'm fairly sure we're not kin. Fairly sure. I got there and she had got fired up at camp. Man, she was on fire for God. She'd been raised in that church her whole life. And she had this weird Bible. Now, I don't mean it wasn't a King James Bible. It was a King James Bible. But it was made a little different. It had a little different cover. And she was reading it one day. And I said, what is that? And she said, oh, it's a 1-year Bible. Maybe some of you have seen those. And it's the King James Bible, but it's already split up into 365 days, January 1st, January 2nd. And it gives you a little bit of the Old Testament, a little bit of the New Testament, Psalms and Proverbs. And if you'll read through that thing, you can read the whole Bible in a year. I said, what in the world? I've never seen anything like it. I said, why are you doing that? And here's what she said. She said, our preacher tells us we have to try and read the Bible through every year. And I thought, well, my preacher didn't ever say that. But then my macho kicked in. And I'm like, but if you can do it, because you're a girl. I can do it. I know we don't believe like that now. That's 20 years ago when we were cavemen. But that's what it was. I was a little bit like, well, yeah, we all read the Bible every year. Everybody does. I'm like, I'm behind. I started getting old. But you know what? From that day since, I've been provoked to read the Bible. Now see, we used to have them little boards. Some of you grew up in some smaller churches and maybe you had those little boards and it had the attendance on the board. How many of you know what I'm talking about? And if you had the Sunday school kind, it would say things like this sometimes. Brought Bible. Did any of y'all have that one? And so you had to bring your Bible to Sunday school. They'd say, how many you brought your Bible? They'd come, and then it would say, read Bible daily. Wow. Oh. You didn't want to be the person that didn't raise their hand. I know people lied all the time. I guarantee they lied all the time. So what we would do is be like, oh man, I gotta read. So just right before you went to bed, you'd open it up and read like one verse. I mean, you know, that's not great, but at least I ain't lying. And so I'd read one verse and then I'd go to bed. Or you get to that, you know, there's one psalm that's just two verses. Y'all know that one, Psalm 117, I think it is? That thing's just two verses. So I could read that chapter every day. I read a chapter a day. But it was all, so at Sunday school, I could raise my hand. But I've never had anybody say you ought to read the whole Bible. I'm going to be honest with you. When I read the whole Bible, I read things I couldn't believe was in the Bible. I remember reading it thinking, I don't even know if you can say that. I did read scripture in Leviticus. How many of you know Leviticus is hard to read? Say amen. You get over there in that leprosy stuff, that is crazy stuff. If it's a black spot with a white hair, you're going to die. You're gone. If it's a white spot with a white hair, you'll probably be okay. Go see the priest. That's some wild stuff. Now, I know it's inspiring. You've got to read. It's all good. But it didn't help me for the longest time until I got a little older and I found that one that said, if a man be bald toward the front of his face, he is forehead bald, but he is clean.
Hey!
I said, that's my life verse now. I'm clean. So get off of me, you hairy people.
Oh. That's brother.
Brother Burton's challenged you to read the person. You know what that is? That challenge is part of the plan. Just like Joseph getting up and saying, Pharaoh, here's what we're going to have to do. We're going to have to find us a man, and that man's going to have a plan, something like this. That for those 7 good years, we need to take a fifth of everybody's produce, and we need to store it up, and we'll do this, and we'll do that. And he had a plan, and God gave them a man with a plan. And the Bible said that Pharaoh and the people all liked the plan. And they said, whatever you say, we'll do it. See, Brother Burton's got a plan for this church to help you preserve the Word of God. Are you in on it?
Amen.
I'm fairly sure Solid Rock promotes reading the Bible. Brother Charlie likes the Bible. He's preached at our church many times about the Bible. We sing the song, you know, the Bible. I love the old Bible, the blessed old Bible. We'll sing that song. And let me ask you something, Bible College. Are you reading it all by yourself, or is it just the college stuff?
Oh.
I know you don't have a lot of time, but I'm just telling you. Because here's what will happen. You'll think, well, I'm a Bible person, and then you'll graduate, and you don't have those assignments anymore. And you've not developed an everyday I read the Bible.
Yeah, that's right.
You developed doing your homework, but you've not developed every day I get in the book all by myself. And that's what you got to have. Are you following the plan? God's giving you a plan, but that don't mean everybody in here is in on it. And you got to be in on it. We admonish you to memorize the Bible periodically. We say read it personally. Memorize it periodically. Get it in your heart. Hey, listen, if they come and forcibly take our Bibles, what's hid in our heart might be all we have.
That's right. Yeah.
What have we hid in our heart? And I'm not good at that, but I've been working. I've been convicted. I didn't have the privilege of Christian school. I didn't have the privilege of Bible college. I'm taking some online now. Hey, but listen, I didn't have people when I was young forcing me to memorize scriptures, and so I'm behind. I get convicted when other preachers get up. Brother Kurt Skelly knows the whole Bible just about. When he preaches, he quotes passages, and the Lord smites my heart and says, you need to do better. So I've got an app on my phone at Scripture Memory. This week I put some new verses in it. I was going over some. You said, why is that? Because, listen, this is it.
Yeah.
Amen.
Yeah.
And we challenge you to read it personally, and we admonish you to memorize it periodically. We suggest you study it corporately. That's come. Come to Sunday school.
Yeah.
10 o'clock, I guess it is. Isn't it normal? We study the Bible in Sunday school. Come Sunday morning and hear preaching. Come Sunday night and hear preaching. Come Wednesday night and hear teaching of the Word of God or preaching of the Word of God. Together, corporate. Hey, when your church has meetings and you're here on a Saturday night, this is Saturday night, right? You're here on a Saturday night, so obviously you do, but I'm just telling you, if this book gets let go, we're going to be in trouble.
That's right.
Now, here's the thing, brother, like me and you, we know about it. But there's coming a time when there's going to be some people out there that don't know about it. According to that prophecy, they don't know about it, but they realize they need some truth. They ain't going to be able to find it because we've let it go. But let it never be said that there's not a church in Philly where there ain't some bread.
Amen.
Or in Berlin, or in Mary, or in wherever it is we all end up. How are you in the Bible tonight? It's no joke. I know I like to preach the glory messages a lot better than this. I like to preach the funny messages a lot better than this. But I'm leaving in the morning. There's probably nothing I can say that'll truly help us any better than this.
Amen.
As I get older, I appreciate the Bible more than I ever have before. When I was preaching the other night, I told you all the first night, and I don't know who you want to have sing, brother. They can go ahead and get ready to the piano or whatever. You want me to call them somebody? Miss Candy, go ahead and just play. Miss Candy's not. Oh, there she is. Miss Candy, you all right?
Good.
Praise the Lord. Hey, y'all turn and look at her. She'll love that. Everybody just turn and look. How are you in the Bible? Are you reading it? It's not a joke. It's not a game.
Amen.
It's the bread of heaven. It's where our power comes from. We saw that verse. It's where our faith comes from. It's where our hope comes from. How are you? Maybe we just ought to repent a little bit tonight and say, Lord, I need to do better in my Bible. Let me ask some of us this that have been doing it a long time. There's all kind of truths in the Bible that show us God expects increase in our lives. And she told me 22 years ago, the preacher says we should read our whole Bible through every year. Now, that's good, but if 22 years later that's all I'm still doing, God's not seeing a lot of increase. And I need to do better. You say, but other people ain't reading. It doesn't matter. He's not comparing me to other people.
That's right.
He's comparing me to me 20 years ago. So some of us that, yeah, some of you have been sitting here like this. Man, I'm glad he's preaching on that because I do read. I got this Bible thing. Yeah, but are you still reading the same amount you were when you were 16 and you first got right with God? Well, then where's the increase? He saw that fig tree afar off and it had leaves on it. Because it had leaves on it, if you know anything about it, it should have had fruit on it. And he saw it afar away and he had an expectation. Then he came to it and had an inspection. And there was no fruit on it. So he cursed it. And some of us, he would say, you've been saved 5 years. There should be increase.
Yeah. Right.
You've been saved 10 years. You should be doing a little better with your Bible than you were 10 years ago. And what if he comes close tonight and inspects that? Will he find increase? Are you better with the Bible than you were 5 years ago? Than you were 10 years ago? Because we're getting further into the last days and it's going to be harder to find it. Let's all stand. Brother Bert, you come through the invitation as you see fit. Father, I pray that you'd help us to get a fresh appreciation for the bread of heaven.